So, fun fact about Adam Gontier of Saint Asonia, our guest here tonight on Loudwire Nights, you actually had the displeasure of being the first musician I've ever interviewed. It happened in Miami at a go-kart racing facility where fans got to ride with Adam Gontier. You were promoting 1X. It was 13 years ago, so I just wanted to apologize all these years later and welcome you to the show, Adam.
Hey, how's it going? I didn't know that. That's cool. I actually remember that. I remember doing the go-karting in Miami, but I don't remember the interview with you. So it must have been like it was fine. It wasn't like I left there thinking that was horrible or anything.
Yeah, it was probably just bad enough to forget, but not so bad that I'm embarrassed to admit it. So yeah, that's amazing you remember that. All right. So I actually use that as inspiration for this little interview segment. It's called The First Time with Adam Gontier. And it's really just three questions and then we'll fast forward back into 2019. But do you remember your first big media interview and like that moment you realized that, okay, I'm here creating art. So all of a sudden people want to dissect it and me?
Well, I mean, I don't remember the actual, like the very first one, but you know, in that period of time, I do remember we were living in Toronto when we had just got signed, 3 Days Grace, and we put out our first single in the local radio station that we always listened to growing up, The Edge here in Toronto. They played the song, they had us in, and it was a studio that was open on the street so people could just come down and watch and hang out. And there was a ton of people there, and it was just, I think that was the first one for me that I remember being like, this is pretty surreal.
Do you remember the first big show you ever did?
I think the biggest show that we did early on was in Brazil, and we played at the Rock in Rio site, and we were the only international band to play that festival. It was a lot of metal bands and heavy bands from Brazil, and we were the only international band. There was about 30,000 people there, and that was pretty amazing. So I think that was our first really big one, and that one will always stand out to me for sure.
Was that scary as all hell?
Yeah, I mean, it was. I think it was more fun, and there was a lot more adrenaline. So, I mean, once you get on stage, any you know, all those nerves and stuff that you're thinking about before you go on tend to disappear as soon as you start playing. So, yeah, it wasn't. It was a little bit nerve-wracking before we went on, but once we went on, it was pretty awesome.
All right, this will be our last blast from the past one. I know everybody remembers the first time they heard themselves on the radio, right?
I remember driving from Peterborough, the town that I was born in, small town, driving up to Toronto, and I heard it on the radio, again, on the Edge in Toronto, and I pulled over. I had to just pull over and listen to it. It was cool because the song was jammed between, you know, it was like Soundgarden and Pearl Jam or something, and it was yeah, that was a big moment for me, for sure. I pulled over, listened to it, heard them talk about it, and kept driving. But yeah, it's pretty awesome.
All right, cool. Thank you for that. We'll come back to 2019 now and talk about Saint Asonia's sophomore album. It's called Flawed Design. So what does Flawed Design mean to you?
You know, I think on this record, there was I did a lot of online stuff, like, you know, on Instagram and all these online social media platforms and stuff. It seems like a lot of people try to be maybe something that they're not, you know, and I get the impression that society wants to be perfect, tries to be perfect for the most part anyway. And I wrote a song on the record called Flawed Design, and it was basically looking at that. It was just exploring how, you know, everybody obviously has flaws in it. I think it's, you know, to embrace those flaws, you know, enjoy them, embrace them, and actually, you know, be a real person is something that a lot of people struggle with, myself included. So, I just wrote the song Flawed Design about that, about not always trying to be perfect, and turned out to be a really cool song, and it seemed to make sense to name the record Flawed Design.
How do you, I don't know if you use the word embrace, but how do you embrace your flaws? How do you switch that in your brain from, I hate this about myself, to, you know, this is good?
Well, I think part of it is just knowing that you're not, coming to a realization that you're not perfect, and realizing what your flaws are, and then trying to use them to your benefit, or trying to make you a stronger person or a better person because of them. I mean, it's all those those things that we go through, you know, failure and all that stuff that that helps us become the person we want to be or the person that we are. So I think it's the same with your imperfections and your flaws and, you know, embracing them and not trying to shut them off, rather just accepting them and accepting yourself.
What are some of the other themes that are explored on this collection of songs?
There's quite a few. The last couple of years for us, last few years for us, have been pretty overwhelming in a lot of different ways. You know, my son was born, so we actually took some time off for that. You know, I ended up checking myself into a rehab center in Minneapolis. That was really important. So a lot of songs are about personal issues and dealing with that sort of stuff, just dealing with life issues, really.
Given that rehab stint, and that you were also going through something similar during 1X, and you said that you're super proud of 1X, you're comparing this record to that kind of pride in your work. It seems like you were going through kind of similar life situations when writing these records.
Yeah, you know, there are. Mainly that, in particular, the checking into rehab and, you know, working on myself, that sort of thing. I did that, you know, and I wrote a lot of the songs for 1X while I was in that treatment center back in 2005. And kind of the same thing this time around. Wrote a lot of these songs and a lot of the lyrics and stuff in this treatment center. So, yeah, I think a lot of things just sort of lined up similar, I guess. This time around, becoming a father is a big piece for me, and that's definitely portrayed on this record for sure.
Yeah, I generally ask how fatherhood has changed the music that you make, but in your case, it seems like fatherhood changed everything, like life, perspective, what inspires you. What is your favorite part of being a dad, and how many thousands of ways did it change your music?
Wow. Well, I mean, just being that person that my son looks up to and feels, you know, feels safe around and feels protected by and all that stuff. I mean, everything about fatherhood is amazing, and it's really hard to you know, just specifically yeah. Nail a few things. I mean, the whole thing is incredible. But, I mean, I was in a really bad place a couple of years ago, and if it wasn't for him being born, I really don't think I would have made it back from the place that I was in. You know, he basically gave me the motivation to move forward and power through and gave me the strength. You know, I've been through rehab and been through my battles with addiction for years, but nothing compares to the strength that I have this time around. And it's been amazing. It's been a crazy couple of years, but for the absolute best. You know, I was writing when we did the first Asonia record, a lot of that record was about me sort of hitting a reset button on my life, you know, getting remarried and that sort of thing. And it's almost like there's another reset button being hit here with getting into sobriety fully and being a father.
Oh, congratulations to you and your beautiful family. I know he's like 2 years old already, but at any rate, congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Of course. You wrote with Dustin Bates of Starset, so I can only imagine that you had multiple deep conversations about automation if you were in the same room.
Well, when I was living in Minnesota a couple of years ago in Minneapolis, Starset came through and I was hanging out with Dustin, and we talked about doing some writing together. And then it just worked out that he had a couple tracks that he'd been working on, and he sent them to me. And then I, you know, worked on them at my end, did some tweaking to a melody and a lyric here and there. And yeah, so we wrote remotely, really. We sent ideas back and forth, and then I took them in the studio.
Okay. Was that the same deal with Sully Erna? Because I know he co-wrote the current single, The Hunted, and then he's featured on it. Was it kind of like a back-and-forth email situation?
Well, that one actually was written a couple years ago. It was sort of written a couple years ago, and Mike Mushak had always had that song. And I've always loved that song. And him and Sully wrote the song a few years ago for, I believe, a soundtrack for a movie that was coming out. But it never ended up in the soundtrack. And Mike basically put it on the shelf for a little while. So this time around when we were making the record, I sort of threw it out at Mike and Sully and said, hey, you know, I really like this song. It'd be cool if I could put my take on it, you know, just mess with things a little bit. So Sully recorded the vocals in Germany with our producer, Brian Sperber. He was on tour at the time. But Mike had all the music and all that sort of stuff all kind of ready to go. So Sully had written it a couple of years ago, so we didn't really need to sending ideas back and forth with him. But yeah, it's a cool song, a really cool song. I'm glad it's on a record.
All right, very cool. They say that it's comforting to be around family, right? How is it having your cousin in the band now?
Oh, it's awesome. Kale and I grew up playing music together, literally as far back as I can remember, like 5 years old. We always wanted to and planned on having a band together. And early on in the early Three Days Grace days, Kale played guitar for a minute. And he's always been a part of everything that I've done musically. So it just made so much sense to have Kale in the band, and it was a no-brainer. Corey moved on to play guitar with Cedar full-time, and at the same time, I was asking Kale if he wanted to play bass in the band, so everything worked out perfect. And it is really nice having Kale in the band, just, you know, for touring, just hanging out. He's such a great guy and basically a brother to me, and it's nice having that support on the road as well.
Awesome. I'm glad to hear you've had a great couple of years, Adam. We will wrap our interview. Yeah. Adam Gontier, Saint Asonia, their upcoming album titled Flawed Design, expected out around October-ish, right? Is that the latest? Is there anything, the last I read, October-ish?
Yeah, no, I believe, yeah, the beginning of October-ish. I think it's first or second week in October, but I don't, not 100% on the date yet, but
okay. I'm there. When those details become public, we'll share them with you. Surely a tour will follow. Thank you so much, Adam. All the best to you and your band.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it.